There is so much untapped potential of what's on the paint bridge. So there are numerous drops, at least two on the rail, several actually that's on the bottom. I could pick out painted detail. So there's a lot of discoveries to be made. They all look extremely old, original to the venue, such as this one. This type of painting, however, this is a painted legacy that is rapidly disappearing. It's irreplaceable scenic art. It's very different than contemporary stage backings. It's a different paint, it's a different application method, how they were created, the artisans that created them. Almost every theater managed to have a paint bridge that went across. And the entire idea of a paint bridge is that artists would be able to be up and out of the way. The canvases or wings, which are framed flats, could easily go up and down. So an artist didn't crawl up and down to actually paint the scene. The scene was raised and lowered through a series of windlasses or pulleys or whatever system to raise and lower the scenery. So you'd have a series of scenic artists up on the paint rail. There could be a rehearsal or a performance going on below. They were limited from a building standpoint of you couldn't really assemble a flat or do construction during a performance because you could hear that, but you could certainly paint. And that didn't allow any problems or issues unless, let's say, maybe a fight broke out and paint spills to the floor or someone does a quick crossing from stage right to stage left and kicks over a bucket of paint. I mean, there are all of these humorous stories about how people really got showered with dry pigment and color mid-performance. So it is an amazing legacy to have that paint bridge. They are taken out so many times erroneously without really thinking of the heritage of who crossed that stage and that they're still functional. You could have a painting studio here. You could paint scenery here. You could provide an experience that you can barely find anywhere with being able to recreate scenery for the stage. It's an amazing artifact to still have in that stage. There are those moments when you can literally weep, and because so many have been taken down for whatever reason is being given to justify the removal, it is incredibly important to the history to understand that generations of American audience, generations of worldwide audiences, that's where the artistic paintings were produced. That's the gallery that both displays, and it's the studio where the manufacture of the painting occurs. So it's all encompassed in one space. It began here and it ended here. The individuals who painted these backdrops began when they were 16 years old, were apprenticed, lived through this entire system, painted 10 to 12 hours a day, 6 days a week, for decades of their career. Their expertise is unmatched with any scenic artist that we have right now. You know, it's very controversial because we talk about who was painting scenery. Were they a bunch of white guys? Were they women? Were they people of color? Who was creating the scenes? There's a legacy that's written down that would suggest there were numerous men painting scenery. And yet by 1898, Great Wisher out of the Pacific Northwest started painting scenery. And various records show her in her dress and smock over it, painting scenery on a paint bridge. So it's the idea, the excitement for me, because I have never crossed a paint bridge before. I've never really been able to experience that. And to be up there, to have the challenge of, because you know, there weren't elevators, there weren't steps or anything, to climb up the ladder in full Victorian dress, to paint and mix your paint, because this is an arduous process. It's not crack open a can of paint and scoop a little out, thin it to your consistency and apply it. This is grind up the color, turn it into a paste, it has to be just so. Heat up your glue granules, make it into a honey syrup, dilute it just so that it's that perfect consistency, which is still the same test of you dip your fingers in and when you hear that perfect snap, it's ready to go. There are all of these things that come bubbling up, and we, as a theater industry, we forget sometimes those who come before us, We celebrate the legacies of a few, but it's all of their predecessors who helped build those legacies, and those are the unforgotten people, the ones who don't make history books, the ones who aren't remembered. So the stage at Trinidad right now is preserving that history. Yes, there's dirt and there's a lot of stuff that has to be dealt with, but it is a time capsule and it is something worth saving. And it is a resource for not only your average citizen, but for academicians and historians and artists and you name it. This goes beyond entertaining future audiences. It's a historical resource.